Well, something else I remember about the war, and well, this is, of course, you call this after the war, but Melbourne Park, as most of you know, the locals know, that was the breeding place for the manufacture of mustard gas, say, and as the what they call the manufacturing plant, as you know, was in Melbourne Park, and hundreds of cans of this year, what do you call this stuff? What is this lethal? What do you call it? Was there stacked in sorry, the track there, and right, and well, you've all, and everybody's heard about this. What do you call? There's been fear that this year all these hundreds of gallons of gas that were put into that big hole in Melbourne Park. They've all heard about that, I expect. But there's a lot of people that don't know that in that big hole there's an international TD18 track layer that dug that hole out, bulldozed all those hundreds and hundreds of gallons of mustard gas into this hole, and then they put the tractor, because it was in such a mess and it was said that they'd never be able to clean it with all this here gas, they put that in the hole and got another bulldozer and covered it up, and put a chain link fence around it so that nobody could get in there. And now there is a lot of talk about it seeping out into the water courses and contaminating the soil and that sort of thing, deadly stuff as it is. Well, I remember getting under this chain link wire on one occasion to go in there on a shooting day and drive the pheasants out. But anyway, it's been a sore point with the villagers around there. Well, all right, yes, that's it. When the war finished, of course, it was destroyed. And in Melbourne Park, they destroyed hundreds of tons of ammunition and small-time bombs and shells and whatnot, hundreds of tons of them. They were going for weeks and weeks there. You could see the fires in the sky, like, well, the plume of smoke. And all right, and that was the RAF doing that, but a lot of it was American material that they were destroying. And as I say, it was the RAF doing the work. And in the end, when they were satisfied that they had destroyed all this here dangerous stuff there, and there was bomb holes about there, not huge bomb holes, but there were bomb holes and miscellaneous bits of this and that, bomb fins and shell cases and so on. And anyway, I had the job of ploughing up Melbourne Park, what do you call, before reseeding it. Yes, I ploughed it up, and okay, we're ready for reseeding. So we go over there with the low load and another smaller tractor on it, and a trailer. There was myself, yeah, put myself first, of course. And then there was a young chap with us whose job, first job it was, who now lives across the fields there anyway. And all right, this young lad, he was to, I'm to drive the tractor and he's to ride on the drill. So, okay, we set off. And each time we went round this here park with a drill, and we got harrows on the back. And each time we got up to our base, we'll call it, where the low load was and the, what they call it, the trailer. Each time we got up there, there was a collection of, what should we say, miscellaneous rubbish in the harrows. A piece of concrete, a piece of steel, a bit of metal, or a tin of some description, or a piece of an IB, incendiary bomb, yeah, the IB, to be referred to as IBs from now on. And, right, each time we got round there, this little heap, there's no tomfoolery about this. I had to go behind, you see, and lift the harrows up and throw out any of this here debris into a pile, which got a bit bigger each time we went round, bit of concrete and metal, as I said. And on this one occasion, when we got back, there was, I don't think there'd been an IB in there, not whole, before. But there were pieces of IBs in the harrows on previous rounds. And I lifted up the harrows in the usual way and took out this here dirty old mud-caked IB, and this was a complete one. And quite without looking, I threw it more or less behind me onto the heap, yes, onto the heap, and within split seconds, it detonated. And it wasn't one of the sort of bombs that Uncle Sam had been using, dropping on Germany, but it was a new addition, shall we say, one of those with an explosive charge in it to keep the folk away from putting buckets and tin hats on top of it when it was dropped. And okay, it went off, and good God, it was throwing what they call ignited pieces out onto our trailer around the low, and that it was having a real vino, it was, this bomb. And I grabbed up a shovel and proceeded to smother it. I know you can't put out an incendiary bomb by tipping water on it, and you've got a job to put one out by smothering, because it carried its own oxygen supply. But anyway, I was doing my best to keep it from going on our trailers, quad, whatever we got there. And then just now, I heard a yell from behind me. I turned round and looked, and this young fellow to whom I referred a little while ago, he was there holding his hand. A piece of the bomb had, when it exploded, perhaps I forgot about that, to say that the bomb exploded, and it threw pieces everywhere, you could see. Well, I was looking over it with a shoulder, what they call, and this chap was looking over my shoulder, and when he yelled out, and I turned to look, like I said a moment ago, I think, he was holding his hand, and there was blood everywhere, and good God, what's happened to you, Brian? And where were you then? He said, the piece has gone through my hand, which it had. It had gone not from front to back, but from side to side, this piece of bomb had. And I said, well, where were you? What were you doing? He said, I was only looking over your shoulder. Oh, God. Yes. And there he was. Of course, the chap was frantic. And blood was everywhere. So, okay, I wrapped his hand up in a duster or whatever I had there. And all right, I got my car there, as it happened at the time, too. And bundled him in the car, off down to Risley to, oh, there's no doctor in this village. Oh, well, that's helpful. Okay, you'll have to go to Sharnbrook. I go to Sharnbrook, and, oh, sorry, but the doctor's out on his round. Oh, that's nice. Well, what now? Oh, you'll have to take him to Bedford Hospital. So I go herring off to Bedford through the 30-mile limits or anything what was there, with him sitting at the side of me, looked like dying any minute. And, well, I got him to hospital. And, well, yes, he's still alive now, because he's down the bottom of those fields living in that house.